internal, and then a counter argument to Bob Rubin by Bruce Bartlett, who was a Treasury official in the Reagan administration, but has turned quite sharply against Republican fiscal policy. And he answered Rubin as Rubin the optimist, got answered by Bruce the pessimist in Financial Times' blog. I'm with Bruce in the pessimist school. Rubin said that there were a number of factors coming together. You probably all are so well read, you already know about this, so I apologize if I'm telling you what you already know, but the so-called fiscal cliff we face that you hear very little about in the election. But actually, when attention turns in the final weeks before the election, it could become more important. Rubin said this presents a, quote, extraordinary second opportunity, unquote, for the so-called grand bargain that President Obama and Speaker John Boehner came very close to last summer, and then this so-called super committee, the not-so-super committee that didn't do anything at all in the fall. Well, Rubin sees that as an extraordinary second opportunity. Bartlett sees it as wishful thinking. And just the confluence of events, it is, of course, the expiration of the Bush tax cuts, which will cost four, if they continue, it will cost $4 trillion over the next decade. $1 trillion if it's, well, it will cost $3 trillion if Democrats get their way, and it only expires for the wealthiest people. So either way, you're going to be, if either side has its way, you're going to still be adding a lot to future deficits. The payroll tax cut of 2010 expires for 160 million Americans. So do the long-term unemployment benefits. We heard that, you know, long-term unemployment is greater than at any time since unemployment compensation was created. And it's amazing to think that we're, you know, it's everybody, both parties are sort of starting to acknowledge or acquiesce in its expiration, except the unemployment rate will still be higher than it is most of the time that unemployment, emergency unemployment compensation is legislated in past recessions. So there'll be no fix for the AMT. Those of you who pay the alternative minimum tax, and those of you who don't, may find yourself paying it next April, because it expired at the end of 2011. This year, for 2012, you may pay the AMT unless they get a deal that would include a fix so that the AMT doesn't ensnare a bunch of you who, like me, consider yourselves middle class, but still, you know, make a nice income. And then, of course, there'll be the automatic cuts of $1.2 trillion half in defense if they don't come to an alternative agreement. Together, CBO said last week that this would cause a recession. If all these spending cuts and these tax increases did indeed happen, it would cause a recession in the first half of next year. Neither party wants that to happen. The trouble is the Democrats and Republicans disagree on which parts they want to, don't want to happen. So my predictions is are that nothing will happen before the election. The Republicans won't shift on being anti-tax either before or after the election, and in turn, then Democrats won't support any change in the entitlement programs, Medicare and Social Security, which have to see some change in the next few years over time because the increases cannot be sustained given the retirement of baby boomers like myself and David, who are beginning to look at drawing on the system. So the divide could harden. I would just say that last August when Speaker Boehner and President Obama talked, they came very close to a deal that would have had higher taxes, although they didn't define how that would be, and an increase in the Medicare eligibility age and a change in the Social Security cost of living formula that would have in the future made for, you know, savings in the entitlement programs. Very controversial, but most certainly people now retired wouldn't have felt it. And the gradual change would not have been so great, as you can see by the fact that we're still phasing in the Social Security changes that took effect when Ronald Reagan was president in 1983. So I don't see a big deal like that happening. The lame duck session depends on the election outcome, who has the leverage. I think a deal is most likely if President Obama is reelected and Republicans keep the House and maybe take the Senate, although it might be best to leave the Senate with the Democrats so that you have buy-in. Any bipartisan deal needs buy-in from both sides. If you have Republicans in complete control of Congress, you might see Democrats turning obstreperous like Republicans have been towards President Obama these last few years. And if Obama loses, I think he would try to get a grand bargain, but, you know, what would, lame duck doesn't have much leverage. But if we have President Romney, I think he's going to be spending so much time trying to prove his anti-tax bona fides to the base of the Republican Party that he won't be able to agree to the necessary tax increases. So I think this fiscal cliff, what they're going to do is they're going to, you hear the phrase, kick the can down the road, you're going to hear it again. But long term, I subscribe, and I'll sum up to Herb Stein's law, Herb Stein being the chief economist in the Nixon Ford administrations, who said if something can't continue, it won't. And our current situation can't continue. It isn't because of the recession. I'll just close on this thought that we would be in this budget fix even if there had never been a recession and financial crisis, simply because of the demographics of this country, where you have 78 million baby boomers retiring and no longer working, paying into the system, instead taking out of the system, and because of the inexorable rise in healthcare costs. So something has to be done. I think it has to be balanced. All history would tell you that, and it ain't happening soon. I thought when I first started covering budgets in the mid-80s that I'd never see a surplus in my lifetime, and then I did for 4 years in a row. And then I never thought they'd be squandered so fast, and they were, and now I'm back to thinking I'll never see a surplus again in my lifetime. And I was wrong once, so let's hope I will be wrong again. But the problem is I'm a lot older now than I was the last time I had this thought.
Thank you. Would you give us some historical perspective, please?
Sure. A couple people have mentioned the Great Depression, so that seems that the juxtaposition everybody wants to talk about. So it's important to emphasize this is no close to the Great Depression. Unemployment in the Great Depression in the peak at 25% on average. For certain sectors, it was 30-40%. We're not anywhere close to that. The Great Depression, depending on how you date it, maybe lingered on for 7 years, maybe for 12, depending on how you date it. You can argue that the Federal Reserve, and I actually know a few economists who disagree with the following statement, that the Federal Reserve under Ben Bernanke definitely learned the central lesson of the Great Depression. The central lesson of the Great Depression is that if you're confronted with a significant economic downturn, the last thing in the world you want to do is rigidly adhere to the gold standard and cut the money supply. Between 29 and 32, the money supply in the United States fell by a third. If you just plot that on a graph between 1860 to 1970, it has historically unprecedented, you've never seen anything like it before or since. That turned what should have been a moderate economic downturn into the worst downturn the world had ever seen. And it's important to emphasize that the downturn in the U.S. was far more severe than in other countries. In Japan, where they pursued a very loose monetary policy, and a very mild downturn recovered very quickly. If you want statistical evidence on that, Ben Bernanke actually has a book and a series of well-respected articles documenting that. Obama never got a lot of credit for this, but his first chairman of the Council of Economic Advisors was Christina Ulmer, who also has a series of papers talking about the origin of the Great Depression, the history of the business cycle. Her central message, too, is that if you're in the midst of a terrible downturn, the last thing you want to do is be restricted with the money supply. And that is the last thing we did. The Fed and policymakers today clearly learned. Great Depression. So you can look at this event, and if you're one of the individuals who's unemployed, you're going to look at this and say this is a disaster that's happened. On the other hand, I think if I look at it, I say this is clearly a group of policymakers who learned from the past and appointed the right people to deal with the, to deal with it. I couldn't think of two academics better qualified to think about how to deal with this crisis than Ben Bernanke and Christina Romer. And along those lines, to go back to Jackie's point about no president's ever been elected, the unemployment rate 9% or higher. In some ways, I think that's an unfortunate fact, because that high unemployment rate might reflect dysfunctional politics, it might reflect bad policy choices, but it might also reflect just poor scientific understanding. And to the extent that debates today are so contentious, I think part of the reason they are so contentious is that, as a science, economics isn't very far along. I mean, it's been around a long time, but we're still working at it. It took us about 50 years to figure out the Great Depression. I mean, people in history books you read as though, oh, Keynes figured it out a long time ago. That's actually not true. It took us about 50 years, and we're still figuring it out. And it's probably going to take us 50 years to figure this one out. And 50 years, unfortunately, is a long time to wait for the perfect solution. So to demand a perfect solution from politicians or anyone else is, I think, an unrealistic demand. I don't want to go on too long. I just want to give you, I couldn't give you lots of quotes from the Great Depression. One thing I've learned about, lots of statistics from the Great Depression. One thing I've learned about teaching economic history for 20 years is that audiences tend not to like lots and lots of statistics. So instead, I'm going to give you what audiences, I think, like a little more, which is two really good quotations. So let me give you two quotes, and I think they're going to embody something important. So the first is a quote from Herbert Hoover. He's campaigning for president in the summer of 28, right before the Great Crash, and the onset of the Great Depression. And he says, "We in America today are nearer to the final triumph over poverty than ever before in the history of any land. The poorhouse is vanishing from among us. We have not yet reached our goal, but given the charge to go forward with the policies of the last 8 years, we shall soon, with the help of God, be in sight of the day when poverty will be banished from this nation." Roughly 10 years later, you have Hoovervilles, you have these shanty towns, derisively called Hoovervilles, all over the United States, 25% unemployment. Hoover, a lot of people will look at that quote and say, "Hoover looks like a fool." So 10 years later, Rexford Tugwell, who's part of FDR's Brain Trust, announces the exact opposite view, says, "The cat is out of the bag. There is no invisible hand, there never was. If the depression has not taught us that, we are incapable of education. We must now supply a real, invisible guiding hand to do the task which that mythical, non-existent, invisible agency was supposed to perform but never did." Taken removed from their context, these strike me as fairly pedestrian quotes that could be offered at any time by any undergraduate student, by any MBA, by any politician at any time. What makes them special is their time. But I'd like to think about them a little deeper and get criticized them in some way, but also kind of think about what about them is right. What I don't like about both of them is they're far too partisan and they're fundamentally ahistorical. The truth of the matter is, where America stood in 1929 had nothing to do with the 8 years of Republican policies that came before it. America started out in 1790 as a colony. 95% of the population was in agriculture. A reasonably well-off society, we weren't that wealthy. By 1929, you go from an economy that was almost entirely agricultural to one that's producing close to 40% of all the goods and services produced in the world. The wages of the typical unskilled worker rose by a factor of 10. Think about that. Think about your income going from $50,000 a year to $500,000 a year, from $100,000 a year to $1 million a year. That is a profound and dramatic change. And as much as Hoover would like that to have been about republicanism, republicanism in the big eye had nothing at all to do with that. That was about the power of the market, power of productivity growth to increase wages. Tugwell's statement is equally unsatisfying to me because he ignores the invisible hand wasn't dead, it was not functioning very well. But it clearly lived for about 130 years, and it didn't just live, it thrived to generate the kind of growth that the world had never seen. And I emphasize, I chose the wage as a typical unskilled worker because we often think of American economic growth during the 19th century as immiserating, as destroying the well-being of the typical worker in industrialization. That simple statistic belies that statement. Real wage driving by tenfold is a dramatic statement. If only the rest of the world was in shape now, we could hope for that. So, as we move on, I think what you want to think about is the cyclicality of thinking about the economy. It's not that many years separate Hoover and Tugwell. And today we're kind of in the same environment. We're going to say, Marcus doesn't work. Well, I want to say 20 years ago under Reagan, but I think I'm showing how old I am. So 20 years ago under Reagan, people were saying how great Marcus was. This is the triumph of Marcus, the death of capitalism. Well, it comes and it goes. I think the way you want to think about policy is to say, look, markets are a strong, robust institution. They can handle high marginal tax rates. Between 1940 and 1970, marginal tax rates in the United States and the highest earners were, those earning over $1 million a year were over 90%. For those earning over $100,000 a year, they were 60-70%. They're a robust, strong institution. They can be a Democratic policy, a Republican policy, redistributionist. That said, there are a lot of things you can do to make markets work better if you look historically. And I've gone on a bit, so I'm going to stop here.
Thank you, all of you. I've already had about 60 questions. Many of them, if I look for them quickly, are on the same themes, and I'll try to put them together for sake of efficiency. But I'm intrigued, and I want to ask all of you, for one of you to volunteer to answer this question. This is an unusual one. You'll like it. I'm graduating with a bachelor's degree next year. How long am I going to have to live in my parents' basement? That's not a frivolous question. It gets to a huge, very important voting group, voters 18 to 24. It talks about the central question of our culture, which is, does the next generation expect to live better than the last? And it gets to frustration that we've seen in the atmosphere and elsewhere of the danger that a youth culture that is disengaged and that is alienated can pose to economic and political stability. So anyone want to give a suggestion how long this young lady or young guy is going to have to live in his parents' basement? I asked it as a parent of two.
It's very clear that the answer to that is it depends. I'd like to know a little more about
that's why President Johnson used to say that he wanted a one-armed Congress. On the one hand or the other. Truman said.
I want to know a little more. I want to know, is that a person have a degree in engineering, have a degree in accounting, have a degree in undergraduate medical. I think that will be a much better opportunity for them to find a job before they completely wear out their work. Perhaps if they have a liberal arts degree, and also what's your grade point average, it would set them back. But I would say that this kid has probably got a better chance than his older sibling had 2 or 3 years ago. That one's probably still living in the basement. Because obviously that was a much rougher time to get out of school. But I think the answer is, there are gonna be jobs. There are jobs for people with good technical schools, good engineering schools, in manufacturing, in services, in medical care, in accounting, in engineering. And like anything else, how long that individual lives in their basement is up to two things, them and their parents.
I think the moderator is prerogative of adding a few thoughts myself. Although Mr. Hoffman's talking about engineering and the importance of people who have degrees that directly go into the professions, let me point out that every American president since 1960 has had a liberal arts degree, that the last two Treasury secretaries were English majors. The Treasury Secretary, the last Treasury Secretary said he only hired English majors, and that this society has often profited by having people who are educated as well as trained. So I urge any of you who are degrees, let me just say from one history major to another, that you can get work in that kind of field.
But that wasn't important. It was a liberal arts degree because I had one myself as an undergraduate. I was really speaking more to where the jobs will be in the next 3 or 4 years, and they will be in certain specialties, and then maybe that student will end up in grad school also to further his or her education, which would increase not only, I think, their opportunity of getting a job, but their lifelong income and perhaps satisfaction on the job. So whether it's liberal arts, whether it's accounting, they're all viable educations that have places in the workforce. And but again, it still gets down to the individual. How the grades they did, how they applied, how they network. I talk to students all the time, would be employees, have they had internships if they were able to get them. All of those things improve the odds, since there's no guarantee, that a young person coming out of school or out of high school will get